Hey everybody, welcome back to REISSUED. My name is Andrew. Today I'm going to show you how I have been creating and utilizing mood boards to help me design each space for my home renovation. Now, if you're an amateur designer like me, you might find yourself getting stuck in one of four places. Number one, you have no ideas and can't get the ball rolling because you don't know where to get started. Number two, you have way too many ideas and you need to kind of narrow things down so that it can feel more cohesive in the design. Number three, you have a pretty good idea about what you're going for, but you're terrified to buy anything because you're worried that you'll get everything home and it won't work together in the space. And number four, you're shopping in a lot of vintage stores, thrift stores, liquidation centers that basically have a non-existent return policy. So it's like number three, but like times 10. Surprise, I am all four of those people, and I have been really relying on mood boards in this process to help me kind of get through each step of that decision-making process, right? Making decisions is hard, and that's kind of all that design is. So for me, mood boarding is just about sort of narrowing the options and helping me commit to making decisions in the process of design. So we're gonna start pretty generally here for my beginners out there, and then we're gonna deep dive and go super crazy into detail because that's how I roll. And also because that level of detail is what I found most helpful in making decisions in the process. So 3, 2, 1, go.
This is where I joined the chorus of people that use Pinterest as a starting point for collecting ideas. At this stage, I cast a wide net and include anything that inspires me or feels relevant. Sometimes I like a particular piece of furniture, but not the room it's in. Sometimes I don't really like anything specific in the image, but the vibe just feels right. So if I'm starting to plan a room, I generally try to put the feeling I'm feeling into words and type that into the search bar. If I find a couple things I like, I pin those to my house board and then organize them into rooms. I often look specifically for images of items that are like ones that I already have and love, since I know those will be incorporated into the design. I also use the Pinterest plugin on my Chrome browser that allows me to add images I find anywhere online to my Pinterest boards directly. That way, if I see something I like in my general internet browsing, I can go ahead and add that to my board without having to look for something similar within Pinterest. One particular feature on Pinterest that you might not know about makes all the difference for me. Once you have a couple images in your board, scroll down to the bottom and click Find More Ideas for this section. Here, Pinterest does a little algorithm magic to auto-populate a bunch of images that feel kinda similar to the ones you just added to your board, like it's making a personal mixtape just for you. I love this feature because it brings up some variations of things that I already like and some different ideas that I didn't expect without my having to put those ideas into words and search for them myself. This cuts out a lot of the time and effort of searching for specific trends and looks that I'm into. Some people like to edit down their boards as the design starts to take shape, but I like to leave my boards full as a record of my journey, just in case I need to backtrack or regroup. Taking the mood boarding process to the next level means narrowing the scope of the Pinterest space and creating a greatest hits kind of collage. This is what might be considered the true classic mood board. For my mood boards, I use Keynote, which is the Apple equivalent of PowerPoint, since I don't have Photoshop. I just find this application to be comfortable. Many people use the free online tool Canva. I say use whatever tool is accessible, familiar, and allows you to move, stretch, and crop images freely.
I also like using Keynote so I can make one slide for each room so I can easily scroll from one to the next and kind of get a sense of how one room is going to connect to the next one. So I find that slideshow kind of layout to be really helpful.
I collect my images by either right-clicking and downloading directly or screenshotting when necessary. In my mind, the two objectives here are to see all the right things and only the right things together, and to allow those things to mingle and overlap so we can get a sense of what fits together or not. This is the time to zero in on what colors, shapes, and textures work together to capture the right mood.
I'm gonna jump in here and say that this kind of collage style mood boarding, I think, works best for like kitchens and bathrooms and things that are very finish oriented. I threw together a little mood board like this for my kitchen just to give you kind of an idea. Here it's all about flooring and paint colors and tile and hardware and just about how those elements play together. I decided to show the design process for my workroom because I'm currently in that space and because I've done the least amount of mood boarding for that space, so I was kind of starting from scratch. But basically it's like a white room with a white floor with a bunch of stuff in it. So it's maybe not the best example for this style of collage mood boarding.
Do the tones of the colors play nicely? Are you noticing any recurring shapes? Are you leaning too heavily on one texture? For my home designs, I'm trying to include a nice mix of wood tones, black and white elements, bold graphics, plants, classic lines, and eclectic pieces. Now is the time to butt the big ideas and shopping list items up against each other and see what sticks. Since Keynote can be limited in its abilities, I use a couple of free online tools to help me out. Remove.bg is my holy grail. Open the link in your browser, drag an image in, watch the background disappear, hit download, boom. Now it's ready to mix and mingle on my mood board. Group things together based on what might overlap within the room and what looks nice together. Some people stop at the collage phase, but if you have the time, I recommend proceeding to the layout phase. An amorphous sea of colors and finishes has its limits. Plus, this is where things really get interesting. Essentially, now we want to create a rough layout of the room to get a sense of how things are placed and what works where. I'm not using a CAD-type program, so we need to get creative. As a starting point, I like to throw in a couple walls. Find a digital paint swatch, duplicate it, crop one side, adjust the exposure to give the color a sense of shadow, and boom, we have a corner. And repeat. Let's get a floor in there too. Now that we have that in place, let's lay out the furniture. Be resourceful and flexible in how you customize your furniture images. For my kitchen, the piece from my parents' house that I'm using for an island looks like this. But the inspiration piece from Pottery Barn looks like this. I prefer the black painted finish, but the size and drawers are all wrong. With some duplicating and cropping, I can get pretty damn close to the right look. And if I group all those pieces together, I can easily move the whole piece around as one. And sometimes you need to create things from scratch. I was originally going to go with more open shelving in my kitchen, but after sourcing this barrister bookcase that I love but plan to paint, I wanted to modify my mood board to help me nail down the hardware choices. I simply added some squares, took away the fill, added a border, thicken that up, match the color to my cabinet swatch, and now we have something that looks a lot like doors. The most helpful part of laying out your room in this way is to find a sense of balance. Too much on one side of the room and not enough on the other? That's a balance issue. See what happened when I tried to put the bookcase on the other side of the kitchen? The fridge and the bookcase together feel really heavy, and the other corner now looks super sparse. It works so much better on the other side since the balance of light and dark, full and sparse, is much more even. Even adding accessories can equalize the balance as well. It's also worth noting that I did a preliminary mock-up for my kitchen using the free IKEA kitchen planner. Planning and visualizing a kitchen is all about correct measurements and proportions and function, and using that tool is an awesome place to start. Once I got something I liked, I could choose an angle, export as a PDF, and build my mood board on top of it in Keynote. Again, you can totally stop here in the mood boarding process. However, I sometimes like to go one step further and make my planning as foolproof as possible. Scale is one of the easiest places to make mistakes in planning a room. A tiny light fixture is lost in a massive space, scale issue. Everything in the room feels like it's about the same size, also a scale issue. Our traditional collage-type mood board or even our rough layout may not be very helpful in resolving these issues since we are either estimating or ignoring their actual size, which is why I've sometimes been going a little bit more in-depth in my planning. Two ways to do this. The simple way is just to pay attention to the relationship between the sizes of aspects of a space and adjust accordingly. In my original kitchen mock-up, I didn't think too much about how tall I made the upper shelves. I just went with what felt right. However, when I was getting ready to buy the bookcase, I looked at the dimensions, taped them out on my wall, and realized that the bookcase would be quite a bit shorter than the window and wider than I anticipated. I adjusted my mood board prior to purchasing to be sure that the scale relationship would work. I didn't get really specific. I just made it a little shorter than the window and as wide as the bottom cabinet since those dimensions matched. And it still worked. But I'm glad I checked because the scale of the bookcase could have been a big issue. The more in-depth and accurate way to check for scale is to use the pixel count on the images to get the scale pretty spot on. I use this method for planning my new bathroom to check the proportions of the vanity, medicine cabinet, lighting, sink. Vanity is 48 inches, so 480 pixels. The medicine cabinet is 20 by 26, so 200 by 260 pixels. This takes a little extra effort, but can make all the difference in really being able to visualize the design and the scale of each element. Adjusting the scale can be time-consuming, so I don't always go the extra mile unless I have a specific question that I need answered. However, I think great design is all about attention to detail, and better to sort out as many details as possible before dropping any money, you know?
And that's it. I hope you found this video helpful, or at least found one interesting or helpful tip in this process. If you like this video, hit the thumbs up button, let YouTube and me know that you liked it. Also, if you want to see these rooms come to life in the real world, not just on my computer, go ahead and hit the subscribe button. I am going to be starting to upload videos in the next couple of months with each room as it is finished, which is very exciting, so I hope you'll stick around for that. See you later. No, no, no.